Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. What is to be done? Burning Questions of Our Movement, published March 1902. Chapter 4. The Primitiveness of the Economists and the Organization of the Revolutionaries. Ray Botchidiello's assertions, which we have analyzed, that the economic struggle is the most widely applicable means of political agitation and that our task now is to lend the economic struggle itself a political character, etc., express a narrow view, not only of our political, but also of our organizational tasks. The economic struggle against the employers and the government does not at all require an all-Russia centralized organization, and hence this struggle can never give rise to such an organization as will combine, in one general assault, all the manifestations of political opposition, protest, and indignation, an organization that will consist of professional revolutionaries and be led by the real political leaders of the entire people. This stands to reason. The character of any organization is naturally and inevitably determined by the content of its activity. Consequently, Ray Botchidiello, by the assertions analyzed above, sanctifies and legitimizes not only narrowness of political activity, but also of organizational work. In this case, Ray Botchidiello, as always, proves itself an organ whose consciousness yields to spontaneity. Yet subservience to spontaneously developing forms of organization, failure to realize the narrowness and primitiveness of our organizational work, of our handicraft methods in this most important sphere, failure to realize this, I say, is a veritable ailment from which our movement suffers. It is not an ailment that comes with decline, but one, of course, that comes with growth. It is, however, at the present time, when the wave of spontaneous indignation, as it were, is sweeping over us, leaders and organizers of the movement, that an irreconcilable struggle must be waged against all defense of backwardness, against any legitimation of narrowness in this matter. It is particularly necessary to arouse in all who participate in practical work, or are preparing to take up that work, discontent with the amateurism prevailing among us and an unshakable determination to rid ourselves of it. A. What is primitiveness? We shall try to answer this question by giving a brief description of the activity of a typical social democratic study circle of the period 1894 to 1901. We have noted that the entire student youth of the period was absorbed in Marxism. Of course, these students were not only, or even not so much, interested in Marxism as a theory, they were interested in it as an answer to the question, what is to be done? As a call to take the field against the enemy. These new warriors marched to battle with astonishingly primitive equipment and training. In a vast number of cases they had almost no equipment and absolutely no training. They marched to war like peasants from the plow, armed only with clubs. A student's circle establishes contacts with workers and sets to work, without any connection with the old members of the movement, without any connection with study circles in other districts, or even in other parts of the same city, or in other educational institutions. Without any organization of the various divisions of revolutionary work, without any systematic plan of activity covering any length of time. The circle gradually expands its propaganda and agitation, by its activities it wins the sympathies of fairly large sections of workers and of a certain section of the educated strata, which provide it with money and from among whom the committee recruits new groups of young people. The attractive power of the committee, or league of struggle, grows, its sphere of activity becomes wider, and the committee expands this activity quite spontaneously. The very people who a year or a few months previously spoke at the students' circle gatherings and discussed the question, whither, who established and maintained contacts with the workers and wrote and published leaflets, now, establish contacts with other groups of revolutionaries, procure literature, set to work to publish a local newspaper, begin to talk of organizing a demonstration, and finally turn to open warfare, which may, according to circumstances, take the form of issuing the first agitational leaflet or the first issue of a newspaper, or of organizing the first demonstration. Usually the initiation of such actions ends in an immediate and complete fiasco. Immediate and complete, because this open warfare was not the result of a systematic and carefully thought out and gradually prepared plan for a prolonged and stubborn struggle, but simply the result of a spontaneous growth of traditional study circle work, because, naturally, the police, in almost every case, knew the principal leaders of the local movement, since they had already gained a reputation for themselves in their student days, and the police waited only for the right moment to make their raid. They deliberately allowed the study circle sufficient time to develop its work so that they might, obtain a palpable corpus delicti, and they always permitted several of the persons known to them to remain at liberty for breeding, which, as far as I know, is the technical term used both by our people and by the gendarmes. One cannot help comparing this kind of warfare with that conducted by a mass of peasants, armed with clubs, against modern troops. And one can only wonder at the vitality of the movement which expanded, grew, and scored victories despite the total lack of training on the part of the fighters. True, from the historical point of view, the primitiveness of equipment was not only inevitable at first, but even legitimate as one of the conditions for the wide recruiting of fighters, but as soon as serious war operations began, and they began in fact with the strikes in the summer of 1896, the defects in our fighting organizations made themselves felt to an ever-increasing degree. The government, at first thrown into confusion and committing a number of blunders, for example, its appeal to the public describing the misdeeds of the socialists, or the banishment of workers from the capitals to provincial industrial centers, very soon adapted itself to the new conditions of the struggle and managed to deploy well its perfectly equipped detachments of agents provocateurs, spies, and gendarmes. Raids became so frequent, affected such a vast number of people, and cleared out the local study circles so thoroughly that the masses of the workers lost literally all their leaders. The movement assumed an amazingly sporadic character, and it became utterly impossible to establish continuity and coherence in the work. The terrible dispersion of the local leaders, the fortuitous character of the study circle memberships, the lack of training in, and the narrow outlook on, theoretical, political, and organizational questions were all the inevitable result of the conditions described above. Things have reached such a pass that in several places the workers, because of our lack of self-restraint and the inability to maintain secrecy, begin to lose faith in the intellectuals and to avoid them. The intellectuals, they say, are much too careless and cause police raids. Anyone who has the slightest knowledge of the movement is aware that all thinking social democrats have at last begun to regard these amateurish methods as a disease. In order that the reader who is not acquainted with the movement may have no grounds for thinking that we are inventing a special stage or special disease of the movement, we shall refer once again to the witness we have quoted. We trust we shall be forgiven for the length of the passage. While the gradual transition to more extensive practical activity, writes B.V. in Ray Bocciadiello, number 6, a transition that is directly dependent on the general transitional period through which the Russian working class movement is now passing, is a characteristic feature. There is, however, another, no less interesting feature in the general mechanism of the Russian workers' revolution. We refer to the general lack of revolutionary forces fit for action, all italics ours, Lenin, which is felt not only in St. Petersburg, but throughout Russia. With the general revival of the working class movement, with the general development of the working masses, with the growing frequency of strikes, with the increasingly open mass struggle of the workers, and with the intensified government persecution, arrests, deportation, and exile, this lack of highly skilled revolutionary forces is becoming more and more marked and, without a doubt, cannot but affect the depth and the general character of the movement. Many strikes take place without any strong and direct influence upon them by the revolutionary organizations. A shortage of agitational leaflets and illegal literature is felt. The workers' study circles are left without agitators. In addition, there is a constant dearth of funds. In a word, the growth of the working class movement is outstripping the growth and development of the revolutionary organizations. The numerical strength of the active revolutionaries is too small to enable them to concentrate in their own hands the influence exercised upon the whole mass of discontented workers, or to give this discontent even a shadow of coherence and organization. The separate study circles, the separate revolutionaries, scattered, uncombined, do not represent a single, strong, and disciplined organization with proportionately developed parts. Admitting that the immediate organization of fresh study circles to replace those that have been broken up merely proves the vitality of the movement, but does not prove the existence of an adequate number of adequately prepared revolutionary workers, the author concludes. The lack of practical training among the St. Petersburg revolutionaries is seen in the results of their work. The recent trials, especially that of the Self-Emancipation Group and the Labor Against Capital Group, 19, clearly showed that the young agitator, lacking a detailed knowledge of working class conditions and, consequently, of the conditions under which agitation can be carried on in a given factory, ignorant of the principles of secrecy, and understanding only the general principles of social democracy, if he does, is able to carry on his work for perhaps 4, 5, or 6 months. Then come arrests, which frequently lead to the breakup of the entire organization, or at all events, of part of it. The question arises, therefore, can the group conduct successful activity if its existence is measured by months? Obviously, the defects of the existing organizations cannot be wholly ascribed to the transitional period. Obviously, the numerical, and above all the qualitative, makeup of the functioning organizations is no small factor, and the first task our social democrats must undertake is that of effectively combining the organizations and making a strict selection of their membership. B. Primitiveness and economism. We must now deal with a question that has undoubtedly come to the mind of every reader. Can a connection be established between primitiveness as growing pains that affect the whole movement, and economism, which is one of the currents in Russian social democracy? We think that it can. Lack of practical training, of ability to carry on organizational work is certainly common to us all, including those who have from the very outset unswervingly stood for revolutionary Marxism. Of course, were it only lack of practical training, no one could blame the practical workers. But the term primitiveness embraces something more than lack of training. It denotes a narrow scope of revolutionary work generally, failure to understand that a good organization of revolutionaries cannot be built on the basis of such narrow activity, and lastly, and this is the main thing, attempts to justify this narrowness and to elevate it to a special theory, that is, subservience to spontaneity on this question too. Once such attempts were revealed, it became clear that primitiveness is connected with economism and that we shall never rid ourselves of this narrowness of our organizational activity until we rid ourselves of economism generally. That is, the narrow conception of Marxist theory, as well as of the role of social democracy and of its political tasks. These attempts manifested themselves in a twofold direction. Some began to say that the working masses themselves have not yet advanced the broad and militant political tasks which the revolutionaries are attempting to impose on them, that they must continue to struggle for immediate political demands, to conduct the economic struggle against the employers and the government, one, and, naturally, corresponding to this struggle which is accessible to the mass movement, there must be an organization that will be accessible to the most untrained youth. Others, far removed from any theory of gradualness, said that it is possible and necessary to bring about a political revolution, but that this does not require building a strong organization of revolutionaries to train the proletariat in steadfast and stubborn struggle. All we need do is to snatch up our old friend, the accessible cudgel. To drop metaphor, it means that we must organize a general strike, too, or that we must stimulate the spiritless progress of the working class movement by means of excitative terror. 3. Both these trends, the opportunists and the revolutionists, bow to the prevailing amateurism. Neither believes that it can be eliminated. Neither understands our primary and imperative practical task to establish an organization of revolutionaries capable of lending energy, stability, and continuity to the political struggle. We have quoted the words of B.V., the growth of the working class movement is outstripping the growth and development of the revolutionary organizations. This valuable remark of a close observer, Ray Bocciadiello's comment on BV's article, has a twofold value for us. It shows that we were right in our opinion that the principal cause of the present crisis in Russian social democracy is the lag of the leaders, ideologists, revolutionaries, social democrats, behind the spontaneous upsurge of the masses. It shows that all the arguments advanced by the authors of the Economist letter, in Iskra, number 12, by Krychevsky and by Martinov, as to the danger of belittling the significance of the spontaneous element, of the drab everyday struggle, as to tactics as process, etc., are nothing more than a glorification and a defense of primitiveness. These people who cannot pronounce the word theoretician without a sneer, who describe their genuflections to common lack of training and backwardness as a sense for the realities of life, reveal in practice a failure to understand our most imperative practical tasks. To laggards they shout, "Keep in step. Don't run ahead." To people suffering from a lack of energy and initiative in organizational work, from a lack of plans for wide and bold activity, they prate about tactics as process. The worst sin we commit is that we degrade our political and organizational tasks to the level of the immediate, palpable, concrete interests of the everyday economic struggle. Yet they keep singing to us the same refrain, lend the economic struggle itself a political character. We repeat, this kind of thing displays as much sense for the realities of life as was displayed by the hero in the popular fable who cried out to a passing funeral procession, "Many happy returns of the day." Recall the matchless, truly Narcissus-like superciliousness with which these wiseacres lectured Polekhinov on the workers' circles generally, sick, being unable to cope with political tasks in the real and practical sense of the word, that is, in the sense of the expedient and successful practical struggle for political demands, Rabochidiello's reply, p. 24. There are circles and circles, gentlemen. Circles of amateurs are not, of course, capable of coping with political tasks so long as they have not become aware of their amateurism and do not abandon it. If, besides this, these amateurs are enamored of their primitive methods, and insist on writing the word practical in italics, and imagine that being practical demands that one's tasks be reduced to the level of understanding of the most backward strata of the masses, then they are hopeless amateurs and, of course, certainly cannot in general cope with any political tasks. But a circle of leaders, of the type of Alexeyev and Mishkin, of Kaljurin and Zelyabov, is capable of coping with political tasks in the genuine and most practical sense of the term, for the reason and to the extent that their impassioned propaganda meets with response among the spontaneously awakening masses, and their sparkling energy is answered and supported by the energy of the revolutionary class. Polekhinov was profoundly right, not only in pointing to this revolutionary class and proving that its spontaneous awakening was inevitable, but in setting even the workers' circles a great and lofty political task. But you refer to the mass movement that has sprung up since that time in order to degrade this task, to curtail the energy and scope of activity of the workers' circles. If you are not amateurs enamored of your primitive methods, what are you then? You boast that you are practical, but you fail to see what every Russian practical worker knows, namely, the miracles that the energy, not only of a circle, but even of an individual person is able to perform in the revolutionary cause. Or do you think that our movement cannot produce leaders like those of the 70s? If so, why do you think so? Because we lack training? But we are training ourselves. We will go on training ourselves, and we will be trained. Unfortunately, it is true that the surface of the stagnant waters of the economic struggle against the employers and the government is overgrown with fungus. People have appeared among us who kneel in prayer to spontaneity, gazing with awe, to take an expression from Polekhinov, upon the posterior of the Russian proletariat. But we will get rid of this fungus. The time has come when Russian revolutionaries, guided by a genuinely revolutionary theory, relying upon the genuinely revolutionary and spontaneously awakening class, can at last, at long last, rise to full stature in all their giant strength. All that is required is for the masses of our practical workers, and the still larger masses of those who dreamed of practical work when they were still at school, to pour scorn and ridicule upon any suggestion that may be made to degrade our political tasks and to restrict the scope of our organizational work. And we will achieve that, rest assured, gentlemen. In the article Where to Begin, I wrote in opposition to Rabochidiello, the tactics of agitation in relation to some special question, or the tactics with regard to some detail of party organization may be changed in 24 hours, but only people devoid of all principle are capable of changing, in 24 hours, or, for that matter, in 24 months, their view on the necessity, in general, constantly, and absolutely, of an organization of struggle and of political agitation among the masses. 4. To this Rabochidiello replied, "This, the only one of Iskra's charges that makes a pretense of being based on facts, is totally without foundation." Readers of Rabochidiello know very well that from the outset we not only called for political agitation, without waiting for the appearance of Iskra, saying at the same time that not only the workers' study circles, but also the mass working class movement could not regard as its first political task the overthrow of absolutism, but only the struggle for immediate political demands, and that the masses begin to understand immediate political demands after one, or at all events, after several strikes. But that with our publications which we furnished from abroad for the comrades working in Russia, we provided the only social democratic political and agitational material, and in this sole material you not only based the widest political agitation exclusively on the economic struggle, but you even went to the extent of claiming that this restricted agitation was the most widely applicable. And do you not observe, gentlemen, that your own argument, that this was the only material provided, proves the necessity for Iskra's appearance and its struggle against Trabotch Idealo. On the other hand, our publishing activity actually prepared the ground for the tactical unity of the party. Unity in the conviction that tactics is a process of growth of party tasks that grow together with the party. A precious unity indeed, and by that rendered possible the creation of a militant organization for which the Union Abroad did all that an organization abroad could do. Trabotch Idealo. Number 10, p. 15. A vain attempt at evasion. I would never dream of denying that you did all you possibly could. I have asserted and assert now that the limits of what is possible for you to do are restricted by the narrowness of your outlook. It is ridiculous to talk of a militant organization to fight for immediate political demands, or to conduct the economic struggle against the employers and the government. But if the reader wishes to see the pearls of economist infatuation with amateurism, he must, of course, turn from the eclectic and vacillating Trabotch Idealo to the consistent and determined Trabotch Idealo. In its separate supplement, p. 13, R. M. wrote, "Now two words about the so-called revolutionary intelligentsia proper. True, on more than one occasion it has proved itself prepared to enter into determined battle with Tsarism. The unfortunate thing, however, is that our revolutionary intelligentsia, ruthlessly persecuted by the political police, imagine the struggle against the political police to be the political struggle against the autocracy. That is why, to this day, it cannot understand where the forces for the struggle against the autocracy are to be obtained. Truly matchless is the lofty contempt for the struggle against the police displayed by this worshipper, in the worst sense of the word, of the spontaneous movement. He is prepared to justify our inability to organize secret activity by the argument that with the spontaneous mass movement it is not at all important for us to struggle against the political police. Very few people indeed would subscribe to this appalling conclusion. To such an extent have our deficiencies in revolutionary organizations become a matter of acute importance. But if Martynov, for example, refuses to subscribe to this, it will only be because he is unable, or lacks the courage, to think out his ideas to their logical conclusion. Indeed, does the task of advancing concrete demands by the masses, demands that promise palpable results, call for special efforts to create a stable, centralized, militant organization of revolutionaries? Cannot such a task be carried out even by masses that do not struggle against the political police at all? Could this task, moreover, be fulfilled if, in addition to the few leaders, it were not undertaken by such workers, the overwhelming majority, as are quite incapable of struggling against the political police? Such workers, average people of the masses, are capable of displaying enormous energy and self-sacrifice in strikes and in street battles with the police and the troops, and are capable, in fact, are alone capable, of determining the outcome of our entire movement. But the struggle against the political police requires special qualities. It requires professional revolutionaries. And we must see to it, not only that the masses advance concrete demands, but that the masses of the workers advance an increasing number of such professional revolutionaries. Thus, we have reached the question of the relation between an organization of professional revolutionaries and the labor movement pure and simple. Although this question has found little reflection in literature, it has greatly engaged us politicians in conversations and polemics with comrades who gravitate more or less towards economism. It is a question meriting special treatment. But before taking it up, let us offer one further quotation by way of illustrating our thesis on the connection between primitiveness and economism. In his reply, Mr. N. N. 20, wrote, "The emancipation of labor group demands direct struggle against the government without first considering where the material forces for this struggle are to be obtained, and without indicating the path of the struggle." Emphasizing the last words, the author adds the following footnote to the word path: "This cannot be explained by purposes of secrecy, because the program does not refer to a plot but to a mass movement. And the masses cannot proceed by secret paths. Can we conceive of a secret strike? Can we conceive of secret demonstrations and petitions?" Vade mecum, p. 59. Thus, the author comes quite close to the question of the material forces, organizers of strikes and demonstrations, and to the paths of struggle, but, nevertheless, is still in a state of consternation, because he worships the mass movement. That is, he regards it as something that relieves us of the necessity of conducting revolutionary activity and not as something that should encourage us and stimulate our revolutionary activity. It is impossible for a strike to remain a secret to those participating in it and to those immediately associated with it, but it may, and in the majority of cases does, remain a secret to the masses of the Russian workers, because the government takes care to cut all communication with the strikers, to prevent all news of strikes from spreading. Here indeed is where a special struggle against the political police is required, a struggle that can never be conducted actively by such large masses as take part in strikes. This struggle must be organized, according to all the rules of the art, by people who are professionally engaged in revolutionary activity. The fact that the masses are spontaneously being drawn into the movement does not make the organization of this struggle less necessary. On the contrary, it makes it more necessary, for we socialists would be failing in our direct duty to the masses if we did not prevent the police from making a secret of every strike and every demonstration, and if we did not ourselves from time to time secretly prepare strikes and demonstrations. And we will succeed in doing this, because the spontaneously awakening masses will also produce increasing numbers of professional revolutionaries from their own ranks, that is, if we do not take it into our heads to advise the workers to keep on marking time. See organization of workers and organization of revolutionaries. It is only natural to expect that for a social democrat whose conception of the political struggle coincides with the conception of the economic struggle against the employers and the government, the organization of revolutionaries will more or less coincide with the organization of workers. This, in fact, is what actually happens, so that when we speak of organization, we literally speak in different tongues. I vividly recall, for example, a conversation I once had with a fairly consistent economist, with whom I had not been previously acquainted. We were discussing the pamphlet, Who Will Bring About the Political Revolution? And were soon of a mind that its principal defect was its ignoring of the question of organization. We had begun to assume full agreement between us, but, as the conversation proceeded, it became evident that we were talking of different things. My interlocutor accused the author of ignoring strike funds, mutual benefit societies, etc., whereas I had in mind an organization of revolutionaries as an essential factor in bringing about the political revolution. As soon as the disagreement became clear, there was hardly, as I remember, a single question of principle upon which I was in agreement with the economist. What was the source of our disagreement? It was the fact that on questions both of organization and of politics the economists are forever lapsing from social democracy into trade unionism. The political struggle of social democracy is far more extensive and complex than the economic struggle of the workers against the employers and the government. Similarly, indeed for that reason, the organization of the Revolutionary Social Democratic Party must inevitably be of a kind different from the organization of the workers designed for this struggle. The workers' organization must in the first place be a trade union organization, secondly, it must be as broad as possible, and thirdly, it must be as public as conditions will allow. Here, and further on, of course, I refer only to absolutist Russia. On the other hand, the organization of the revolutionaries must consist first and foremost of people who make revolutionary activity their profession, for which reason I speak of the organization of revolutionaries, meaning revolutionary social democrats. In view of this common characteristic of the members of such an organization, all distinctions as between workers and intellectuals, not to speak of distinctions of trade and profession, in both categories, must be effaced. Such an organization must perforce not be very extensive and must be as secret as possible. Let us examine this threefold distinction. In countries where political liberty exists, the distinction between a trade union and a political organization is clear enough, as is the distinction between trade unions and social democracy. The relations between the latter and the former will naturally vary in each country according to historical, legal, and other conditions. They may be more or less close, complex, etc. In our opinion, they should be as close and as little complicated as possible. But there can be no question in free countries of the organization of trade unions coinciding with the organization of the Social Democratic Party. In Russia, however, the yoke of the autocracy appears at first glance to obliterate all distinctions between the social democratic organization and the workers' associations, since all workers' associations and all study circles are prohibited, and since the principal manifestation and weapon of the workers' economic struggle, the strike, is regarded as a criminal, and sometimes even as a political offense. Conditions in our country, therefore, on the one hand, strongly impel the workers engaged in economic struggle to concern themselves with political questions, and, on the other, they impel social democrats to confound trade unionism with social democracy, and are Krychevskys, Martinoys, and go, while diligently discussing the first kind of impulsion, fail to notice the second. Indeed, picture to yourselves people who are immersed 99% in the economic struggle against the employers and the government. Some of them will never, during the entire course of their activity, from 4 to 6 months, be impelled to think of the need for a more complex organization of revolutionaries. Others, perhaps, will come across the fairly widely distributed Bernsteinian literature, from which they will become convinced of the profound importance of the forward movement of the drab everyday struggle. Still others will be carried away, perhaps, by the seductive idea of showing the world a new example of close and organic contact with the proletarian struggle, contact between the trade union and the social democratic movements. Such people may argue that the later a country enters the arena of capitalism and, consequently, of the working class movement, the more the socialists in that country may take part in, and support, the trade union movement, and the less the reason for the existence of non-social democratic trade unions. So far the argument is fully correct. Unfortunately, however, some go beyond that and dream of a complete fusion of social democracy with trade unionism. We shall soon see, from the example of the rules of the St. Petersburg League of Struggle, what a harmful effect such dreams have upon our plans of organization. The workers' organizations for the economic struggle should be trade union organizations. Every social democratic worker should as far as possible assist and actively work in these organizations. But, while this is true, it is certainly not in our interest to demand that only social democrats should be eligible for membership in the trade unions, since that would only narrow the scope of our influence upon the masses. Let every worker who understands the need to unite for the struggle against the employers and the government join the trade unions. The very aim of the trade unions would be impossible of achievement, if they did not unite all who have attained at least this elementary degree of understanding, if they were not very broad organizations. The broader these organizations, the broader will be our influence over them, an influence due, not only to the spontaneous development of the economic struggle, but to the direct and conscious effort of the socialist trade union members to influence their comrades. But a broad organization cannot apply methods of strict secrecy, since this demands far greater training than is required for the economic struggle. How is the contradiction between the need for a large membership and the need for strictly secret methods to be reconciled? How are we to make the trade unions as public as possible? Generally speaking, there can be only two ways to this end. Either the trade unions become legalized, in some countries this preceded the legalization of the socialist and political unions, or the organization is kept secret, but so free and amorphous, loose five, as the Germans say, that the need for secret methods becomes almost negligible as far as the bulk of the members is concerned. The legalization of non-socialist and non-political labor unions in Russia has begun, and there is no doubt that every advance made by our rapidly growing social democratic working class movement will multiply and encourage attempts at legalization, attempts proceeding for the most part from supporters of the existing order, but partly also from the workers themselves and from liberal intellectuals. The banner of legality has already been hoisted by the Vasilyevs and the Zubatovs. Support has been promised and rendered by the Ozerovs and the Wormses, 21, and followers of the new tendency are now to be found among the workers. Henceforth, we cannot but reckon with this tendency. How we are to reckon with it, on this there can be no two opinions among social democrats. We must steadfastly expose any part played in this movement by the Zubatovs and the Vasilyevs, the gendarmes and the priests, and explain their real intentions to the workers. We must also expose all the conciliatory, harmonious notes that will be heard in the speeches of liberal politicians at legal meetings of the workers, irrespective of whether the speeches are motivated by an earnest conviction of the desirability of peaceful class collaboration, by a desire to curry favor with the powers that be, or whether they are simply the result of clumsiness. Lastly, we must warn the workers against the traps often set by the police, who at such open meetings and permitted societies spy out the fiery ones and try to make use of legal organizations to plant their agents provocateurs in the illegal organizations. Doing all this does not at all mean forgetting that in the long run the legalization of the working class movement will be, to our advantage, and not to that of the Zubatovs. On the contrary, it is precisely our campaign of exposure that will help us to separate the tares from the wheat. What the tares are, we have already indicated. By the wheat we mean attracting the attention of ever large numbers, including the most backward sections, of the workers to social and political questions, and freeing ourselves, the revolutionaries, from functions that are essentially legal, the distribution of legal books, mutual aid, etc., the development of which will inevitably provide us with an increasing quantity of material for agitation. In this sense, we may, and should, say to the Zubatovs and the Ozerovs, keep at it, gentlemen, do your best. Whenever you place a trap in the path of the workers, either by way of direct provocation, or by the honest demoralization of the workers with the aid of Struvism, we will see to it that you are exposed. But whenever you take a real step forward, though it be the most timid zigzag, we will say, please continue. And the only step that can be a real step forward is a real, if small, extension of the workers' field of action. Every such extension will be to our advantage and will help to hasten the advent of legal societies of the kind in which it will not be agents provocateurs who are detecting socialists, but socialists who are gaining adherents. In a word, our task is to fight the tares. It is not our business to grow wheat in flower pots. By pulling up the tares, we clear the soil for the wheat. And while the Afanasy Ivanovichs and Pulcheria Ivanovnas 22 are tending their flower pot crops, we must prepare the reapers, not only to cut down the tares of today, but to reap the wheat of tomorrow. 6. Thus, we cannot by means of legalization solve the problem of creating a trade union organization that will be as little secret and as extensive as possible, but we should be extremely glad if the Zubatovs and the Ozerovs disclose to us even a partial opportunity for such a solution. To this end, however, we must strenuously combat them. There remain secret trade union organizations, and we must give all possible assistance to the workers who, as we definitely know, are adopting this course. Trade union organizations not only can be of tremendous value in developing and consolidating the economic struggle, but can also become a very important auxiliary to political agitation and revolutionary organization. In order to achieve this purpose, and in order to guide the nascent trade union movement in the channels desired by social democracy, we must first understand clearly the absurdity of the plan of organization the St. Petersburg economists have been nursing for nearly 5 years. That plan is set forth in the Rules for a Workers' Mutual Benefit Fund of July 1897, Listok Rabotnika, No. 910, p. 46, taken from Rabotchaya Misl, No. 1, as well as in the Rules for a Trade Union Workers' Organization of October 1900, special leaflet printed in St. Petersburg and referred to in Iskra, No. 1. Both these sets of rules have one main shortcoming. They set up the broad workers' organization in a rigidly specified structure and confound it with the organization of revolutionaries. Let us take the last mentioned set of rules, since it is drawn up in greater detail. The body consists of 52 paragraphs. 23 deal with the structure, the method of functioning, and the competence of the workers' circles, which are to be organized in every factory, a maximum of 10 persons, and which elect central, factory, groups. The central group, says paragraph 2, observes all that goes on in its factory or workshop and keeps a record of events. The central group presents to subscribers a monthly financial account, par. 17, etc. 10 paragraphs are devoted to the district organization, and 19 to the highly complex interconnection between the Committee of the Workers' Organization and the Committee of the St. Petersburg League of Struggle, elected representatives of each district and of the executive groups, groups of propagandists, groups for maintaining contact with the provinces, and with the organization abroad, groups for managing stores, publications, and funds. Social democracy equals executive groups in relation to the economic struggle of the workers. It would be difficult to show more glaringly how the economists' ideas deviate from social democracy to trade unionism, and how alien to them is any idea that a social democrat must concern himself first and foremost with an organization of revolutionaries capable of guiding the entire proletarian struggle for emancipation. To talk of the political emancipation of the working class and of the struggle against czarist despotism, and at the same time to draft rules like these, means to have no idea whatsoever of the real political tasks of social democracy. Not one of the 50 or so paragraphs reveals even a glimmer of understanding that it is necessary to conduct the widest possible political agitation among the masses, an agitation highlighting every aspect of Russian absolutism and the specific features of the various social classes in Russia. Rules like these are of no use even for the achievement of trade union, let alone political aims, since trade unions are organized by trades, of which no mention is made. But most characteristic, perhaps, is the amazing top-heaviness of the whole system, which attempts to bind each single factory and its committee by a permanent string of uniform and ludicrously petty rules and a three-stage system of election. Hemmed in by the narrow outlook of economism, the mind is lost in details that positively reek of red tape and bureaucracy. In practice, of course, 3/4 of the clauses are never applied. On the other hand, a secret organization of this kind, with its central group in each factory, makes it very easy for the gendarmes to carry out raids on a vast scale. The Polish corn raids have passed through a similar phase in their movement, with everybody enthusiastic about the extensive organization of workers' benefit funds, but they very quickly abandoned this idea when they saw that such organizations only provided rich harvests for the gendarmes. If we have in mind broad workers' organizations, and not widespread arrests, if we do not want to provide satisfaction to the gendarmes, we must see to it that these organizations remain without any rigid formal structure. But will they be able to function in that case? Let us see what the functions are. To observe all that goes on in the factory and keep a record of events, par. 2 of the rules. Do we really require a formally established group for this purpose? Could not the purpose be better served by correspondence conducted in the illegal papers without the setting up of special groups? To lead the struggles of the workers for the improvement of their workshop conditions, par. 3. This, too, requires no set organizational form. Any sensible agitator can in the course of ordinary conversation gather what the demands of the workers are and transmit them to a narrow, not a broad, organization of revolutionaries for expression in a leaflet, to organize a fund, to which subscriptions of 2 kopecks per ruble 7, should be made, par. 9, and then to present to subscribers a monthly financial account, par. 17, to expel members who fail to pay their contributions, par. 10, and so forth. Why, this is a very paradise for the police, for nothing would be easier for them than to penetrate into such a secrecy of a central factory fund, confiscate the money, and arrest the best people. Would it not be simpler to issue 1 kopeck or 2 kopeck coupons bearing the official stamp of a well-known, very narrow and very secret organization, or to make collections without coupons of any kind and to print reports in a certain agreed code in an illegal paper? The object would thereby be attained, but it would be 100 times more difficult for the gendarmes to pick up clues. I could go on analyzing the rules, but I think that what has been said will suffice. A small, compact core of the most reliable, experienced, and hardened workers, with responsible representatives in the principal districts and connected by all the rules of strict secrecy with the organization of revolutionaries, can, with the widest support of the masses and without any formal organization, perform all the functions of a trade union organization, in a manner, moreover, desirable to social democracy. Only in this way can we secure consolidation and development of a social democratic trade union movement, despite all the gendarmes. It may be objected that an organization which is so loose that it is not even definitely formed, and which has not even an enrolled and registered membership, cannot be called an organization at all. Perhaps so. Not the name is important. What is important is that this organization without members shall do everything that is required, and from the very outset ensure a solid connection between our future trade unions and socialism. Only an incorrigible utopian would have a broad organization of workers, with elections, reports, universal suffrage, etc., under the autocracy. The moral to be drawn from this is simple. If we begin with the solid foundation of a strong organization of revolutionaries, we can ensure the stability of the movement as a whole and carry out the aims both of social democracy and of trade unions proper. If, however, we begin with a broad workers' organization, which is supposedly most accessible to the masses, but which is actually most accessible to the gendarmes and makes revolutionaries most accessible to the police, we shall achieve neither the one aim nor the other. We shall not eliminate our rule of thumb methods, and, because we remain scattered and our forces are constantly broken up by the police, we shall only make trade unions of the Zubitov and Ozerov type the more accessible to the masses. What, properly speaking, should be the functions of the Organization of Revolutionaries. We shall deal with this question in detail. First, however, let us examine a very typical argument advanced by our terrorist, who, sad fate, in this matter also is a next-door neighbor to the Economist. Svoboda, a journal published for workers, contains in its first issue an article entitled Organization, the author of which tries to defend his friends, the Economist workers of Ivanovo-Voznesensk. He writes, "It is bad when the masses are mute and unenlightened, when the movement does not come from the rank and file. For instance, the students of a university town leave for their homes during the summer and other holidays, and immediately the workers' movement comes to a standstill. Can a workers' movement which has to be pushed on from outside be a real force? No, indeed. It has not yet learned to walk, it is still in leading strings. So it is in all matters. The students go off, and everything comes to a standstill. The most capable are seized, the cream is skimmed and the milk turns sour. If the committee is arrested, everything comes to a standstill until a new one can be formed. And one never knows what sort of committee will be set up next, it may be nothing like the former. The first said one thing, the second may say the very opposite. Continuity between yesterday and tomorrow is broken. The experience of the past does not serve as a guide for the future. And all because no roots have been struck in depth, in the masses, the work is carried on not by 100 fools, but by 12 wise men. 12 wise men can be wiped out at a snap. But when the organization embraces masses, everything proceeds from them, and nobody, however he tries, can wreck the cause." p. 63. The facts are described correctly. The picture of our amateurism is well drawn. But the conclusions are worthy of Rabotche Iomysl, both as regards their stupidity and their lack of political tact. They represent the height of stupidity, because the author confuses the philosophical and social historical question of the depth of the roots of the movement with the technical and organizational question of the best method in combating the gendarmes. They represent the height of political tactlessness, because, instead of appealing from bad leaders to good leaders, the author appeals from the leaders in general to the masses. This is as much an attempt to drag us back organizationally as the idea of substituting excitative terrorism for political agitation drags us back politically. Indeed, I am experiencing a veritable embarras directrices, and hardly know where to begin to disentangle the jumble offered up by Svoboda. For clarity, let me begin by citing an example. Take the Germans. It will not be denied, I hope, that theirs is a mass organization, that in Germany everything proceeds from the masses, that the working class movement there has learned to walk. Yet observe how these millions value their 12 tried political leaders, how firmly they cling to them. Members of the hostile parties in parliament have often taunted the socialists by exclaiming, "Fine Democrats you are indeed. Yours is a working class movement only in name. In actual fact the same clique of leaders is always in evidence, the same Bebel and the same Liebknecht, year in and year out, and that goes on for decades. Your supposedly elected workers' deputies are more permanent than the officials appointed by the emperor. But the Germans only smile with contempt at these demagogic attempts to set the masses against the leaders, to arouse bad and ambitious instincts in the former, and to rob the movement of its solidity and stability by undermining the confidence of the masses in their 12 wise men. Political thinking is sufficiently developed among the Germans, and they have accumulated sufficient political experience to understand that without the 12 tried and talented leaders, and talented men are not born by the hundreds, professionally trained, schooled by long experience, and working in perfect harmony, no class in modern society can wage a determined struggle. The Germans too have had demagogues in their ranks who have flattered the 100 fools, exalted them above the 12 wise men, extolled the horny hand of the masses, and, like Most and Hasselmann, have spurred them on to reckless revolutionary action and sown distrust towards the firm and steadfast leaders. It was only by stubbornly and relentlessly combating all demagogic elements within the socialist movement that German socialism has managed to grow and become as strong as it is. Our wiseacres, however, at a time when Russian social democracy is passing through a crisis entirely due to the lack of sufficiently trained, developed, and experienced leaders to guide the spontaneously awakening masses, cry out, with the profundity of fools, "It is a bad business when the movement does not proceed from the rank and file. A committee of students is of no use, it is not stable." Quite true. But the conclusion to be drawn from this is that we must have a committee of professional revolutionaries, and it is immaterial whether a student or a worker is capable of becoming a professional revolutionary. The conclusion you draw, however, is that the working class movement must not be pushed on from outside. In your political innocence, you fail to notice that you are playing into the hands of our economists and fostering our amateurism, wherein, may I ask, did our students push on our workers? In the sense that the student brought to the worker the fragments of political knowledge he himself possesses, the crumbs of socialist ideas he has managed to acquire, for the principal intellectual diet of the present-day student, legal Marxism, could furnish only the rudiments, only scraps of knowledge. There has never been too much of such pushing on from outside; on the contrary, there has so far been all too little of it in our movement, for we have been stewing too assiduously in our own juice. We have bowed far too slavishly to the elementary economic struggle of the workers against the employers and the government. We professional revolutionaries must and will make it our business to engage in this kind of pushing on 100 times more forcibly than we have done hitherto. But the very fact that you select so hideous a phrase as pushing on from outside, a phrase which cannot but rouse in the workers, at least in the workers who are as unenlightened as you yourselves, a sense of distrust towards all who bring them political knowledge and revolutionary experience from outside, which cannot but rouse in them an instinctive desire to resist all such people, proves you to be demagogues, and demagogues are the worst enemies of the working class. And, please, don't hasten howling about my uncomradely methods of debating. I have not the least desire to doubt the purity of your intentions. As I have said, one may become a demagogue out of sheer political innocence. But I have shown that you have descended to demagogy, and I will never tire of repeating that demagogues are the worst enemies of the working class. The worst enemies, because they arouse base instincts in the masses, because the unenlightened worker is unable to recognize his enemies in men who represent themselves, and sometimes sincerely so, as his friends. The worst enemies, because in the period of disunity and vacillation, when our movement is just beginning to take shape, nothing is easier than to employ demagogic methods to mislead the masses, who can realize their error only later by bitter experience. That is why the slogan of the day for the Russian Social Democrat must be, resolute struggle against Svoboda and Rabotchidialo, both of which have sunk to the level of demagogy. We shall deal with this further in greater detail. 8. A dozen wise men can be more easily wiped out than 100 fools. This wonderful truth, for which the 100 fools will always applaud you, appears obvious only because in the very midst of the argument you have skipped from one question to another. You began by talking and continued to talk of the unearthing of a committee, of the unearthing of an organization, and now you skip to the question of unearthing the movement's roots and air depths. The fact is, of course, that our movement cannot be unearthed, for the very reason that it has countless thousands of roots deep down among the masses, but that is not the point at issue. As far as deep roots are concerned, we cannot be unearthed even now, despite all our amateurism, and yet we all complain, and cannot but complain, that the organizations are being unearthed and as a result it is impossible to maintain continuity in the movement. But since you raise the question of organizations being unearthed and persist in your opinion, I assert that it is far more difficult to unearth a dozen wise men than 100 fools. This position I will defend, no matter how much you instigate the masses against me for my anti-democratic views, etc. As I have stated repeatedly, by wise men, in connection with organization, I mean professional revolutionaries, irrespective of whether they have developed from among students or working men. I assert, 1, that no revolutionary movement can endure without a stable organization of leaders maintaining continuity, 2, that the broader the popular mass drawn spontaneously into the struggle, which forms the basis of the movement and participates in it, the more urgent the need for such an organization, and the more solid this organization must be, for it is much easier for all sorts of demagogues to sidetrack the more backward sections of the masses, 3, that such an organization must consist chiefly of people professionally engaged in revolutionary activity, 4, that in an autocratic state, the more we confine the membership of such an organization to people who are professionally engaged in revolutionary activity and who have been professionally trained in the art of combating the political police, the more difficult will it be to unearth the organization, and, 5, the greater will be the number of people from the working class and from the other social classes who will be able to join the movement and perform active work in it. I invite our economists, terrorists, and economists terrorists, 9, to confute these propositions. At the moment, I shall deal only with the last two points. The question as to whether it is easier to wipe out a dozen wise men or 100 fools reduces itself to the question, above considered, whether it is possible to have a mass organization when the maintenance of strict secrecy is essential. We can never give a mass organization that degree of secrecy without which there can be no question of persistent and continuous struggle against the government. To concentrate all secret functions in the hands of as small a number of professional revolutionaries as possible does not mean that the latter will do the thinking for all and that the rank and file will not take an active part in the movement. On the contrary, the membership will promote increasing numbers of the professional revolutionaries from its ranks, for it will know that it is not enough for a few students and for a few working men waging the economic struggle together in order to form a committee, but that it takes years to train oneself to be a professional revolutionary. And the rank and file will think, not only of amateurish methods, but of such training. Centralization of the secret functions of the organization by no means implies centralization of all the functions of the movement. Active participation of the widest masses in the illegal press will not diminish because a dozen professional revolutionaries centralize the secret functions connected with this work; on the contrary, it will increase tenfold. In this way, and in this way alone, shall we ensure that reading the illegal press, writing for it, and to some extent even distributing it, will almost cease to be secret work, for the police will soon come to realize the folly and impossibility of judicial and administrative red tape procedure over every copy of a publication that is being distributed in the thousands. This holds not only for the press, but for every function of the movement, even for demonstrations. The active and widespread participation of the masses will not suffer; on the contrary, it will benefit by the fact that a dozen experienced revolutionaries, trained professionally no less than the police, will centralize all the secret aspects of the work: the drawing up of leaflets, the working out of approximate plans, and the appointing of bodies of leaders for each urban district, for each institution, etc. I know that exception will be taken to my undemocratic views, but I shall reply below fully to this anything but intelligent objection. Centralization of the most secret functions in an organization of revolutionaries will not diminish, but rather increase the extent and enhance the quality of the activity of a large number of other organizations that are intended for a broad public and are therefore as loose and as non-secret as possible, such as workers' trade unions, workers' self-education circles and circles for reading illegal literature, and socialist, as well as democratic, circles among all other sections of the population, etc. etc. We must have such circles, trade unions, and organizations everywhere in as large a number as possible and with the widest variety of functions, but it would be absurd and harmful to confound them with the organization of revolutionaries, to efface the border line between them, to make still more hazy the all too faint recognition of the fact that in order to serve the mass movement we must have people who will devote themselves exclusively to social democratic activities, and that such people must train themselves patiently and steadfastly to be professional revolutionaries. Yes, this recognition is incredibly dim. Our worst sin with regard to organization consists in the fact that by our primitiveness we have lowered the prestige of revolutionaries in Russia. A person who is flabby and shaky on questions of theory, who has a narrow outlook, who pleads the spontaneity of the masses as an excuse for his own sluggishness, who resembles a trade union secretary more than a spokesman of the people, who is unable to conceive of a broad and bold plan that would command the respect even of opponents, and who is inexperienced and clumsy in his own professional art, the art of combating the political police, such a man is not a revolutionary, but a wretched amateur. Let no active worker take offense at these frank remarks, for as far as insufficient training is concerned, I apply them first and foremost to myself. I used to work in a study circle 23, that set itself very broad, all-embracing tasks, and all of us, members of that circle, suffered painfully and acutely from the realization that we were acting as amateurs at a moment in history when we might have been able to say, varying a well-known statement, "Give us an organization of revolutionaries, and we will overturn Russia." The more I recall the burning sense of shame I then experienced, the bitterer become my feelings towards those pseudo-social democrats whose preachings bring disgrace on the calling of a revolutionary, who fail to understand that our task is not to champion the degrading of the revolutionary to the level of an amateur, but to raise the amateurs to the level of revolutionaries. D. The scope of organizational work. We have heard B.V. tell us about the lack of revolutionary forces fit for action, which is felt not only in St. Petersburg, but throughout Russia. Hardly anyone will dispute this fact. But the question is, how is it to be explained? B.V. writes, "We shall not go into an explanation of the historical causes of this phenomenon. We shall merely state that a society, demoralized by prolonged political reaction and split by past and present economic changes, promotes from its own ranks an extremely small number of persons fit for revolutionary work, that the working class does produce revolutionary workers who to some extent reinforce the ranks of the illegal organizations, but that the number of such revolutionaries is inadequate to meet the requirements of the times. This is all the more so because the worker who spends 11.5 hours a day in the factory is in such a position that he can, in the main, perform only the functions of an agitator, but propaganda and organization, the delivery and reproduction of illegal literature, the issuance of leaflets, etc., are duties which must necessarily fall mainly upon the shoulders of an extremely small force of intellectuals." Ray Bocciadiello, number 6, pages 38-39. On many points we disagree with B.V., particularly with those we have emphasized, which most saliently reveal that, although weary of our amateurism, as is every thinking practical worker, B.V. cannot find the way out of this intolerable situation because he is weighted down by economism. The fact is that society produces very many persons fit for the cause, but we are unable to make use of them all. The critical, transitional state of our movement in this respect may be formulated as follows: there are no people, yet there is a mass of people. There is a mass of people, because the working class and increasingly varied social strata, year after year, produce from their ranks an increasing number of discontented people who desire to protest, who are ready to render all the assistance they can in the struggle against absolutism, the intolerableness of which, though not yet recognized by all, is more and more acutely sensed by increasing masses of the people. At the same time, we have no people, because we have no leaders, no political,